Welcome students to EPG Pathshala. This module is related to History and Philosophy of Social Work, and this particular model is Taxonomy of Social Theories, Overview of Practice Perspectives in Social Work, and this is part one of this Taxonomy of Social Theories. I am Ruchi Sinha. I am a faculty with the School of Social Work and I teach in the Center for Criminology and Justice of Tata Institute of Social Sciences. Now let's get ahead with teaching and learning social work and let's make it more interesting for us. I think it would be good if we understand what is the objectives of this module. It would help you understand and take you steps towards understanding the different practice perspectives. So the first objective is to help you understand the practice perspectives in social work. Second is to enable you to contextualize professional social work ideologies. I'm sure you meet a different variety of social work professionals. You should be able to understand where they come from this module. It will help you understand, realize, and even contextualize the diversity in social work practice that we have. And it will help you engage with the different social work perspectives and practice theory and give you the freedom to move from one practice perspective to the other practice perspective. The contents are easily divided into aspects which you should understand. Introduction, no need to explain that. Subjective, objective dimensions of analysis, notions of society, that is order and conflict, the four dominant paradigms given by Burrell and Morgan, David House taxonomy of social work, and finally the summary. Before I begin this module, it is interesting that Kalshed, a nice social work practitioner, in 1991 itself said that social work theory should never become an end in itself. A truly useful theory would provide guidance towards a more effective practice, giving a measure of confidence so that we do not feel totally at the mercy of our working environment. If we build on and record effective strategies and techniques, then we build transmittable knowledge by directing others to what is common and regularly occurring in human experience. This, in a nutshell, tells us that we do not have to be rigid in our practice and we should be willing to learn and innovate at every step of our practice. There is one concept that will run through this course over and over again, and you would be bombarded by it often. These are two words, perspectives and theories. Please remember and tie it up somewhere in your mind that perspective is a way of looking at the world. How you and me look at the world is very different, and it is not anyone's fault that we look at it differently, but the social worker's point of view is to understand why we look at it differently, and that is the starting point of social work. And theory gives us a very good base to understand why these perspectives are different, and hence theories are a set of interrelated propositions or principles which help us arrive and answer a question, and this makes explanation very easy. But before we get into the perspectives, it's very important to understand that the central notions of social work is basically to help the vulnerable, the marginalized, and the poor. And this is done differently in the changing social context. And every day, right from the beginning, that is the historical evolution of social work, to today, you would notice that helping and the nature of helping has changed, but the context has also changed along with it, and hence the practice paradigm has evolved over time. So what was relevant in the 1950s may not be so relevant today in the same dimension. Social work practice is primarily the means of achieving the profession's end, and hence students, you have to be very, very conscious while you're practicing social work. And it is created within the political, social, and cultural matrixes, and thus the assumptions of practice, the problems that the practice must deal with, and the preferred outcomes of practice is something that this module is going to demystify. And we should understand that the context of practice includes the agency setting, the policy framework, and the large social system in which practice takes place. As I had already said, that since this module is based upon the taxonomy provided by David Howey to understand social work within the social theories, you should be thrilled to know that this model is based upon an organizational organogram provided by Burrell and Morgan. They were trying to understand how organizations function, and David Harvey has borrowed heavily from that model and brought it into the social work dimension. Now, this model has got two key dimensions of analysis, that is subjective versus objective and the regulation versus radical change. Now, if you understand, there is a figure attached to this dimension, but first I will explain what is subjective and what is objective, and then we will go on to understanding the regulation, sociology of regulation of change and sociology of radical change. But again, students, what is interesting is that before we understand the subjective and the objective dimension, there are four concepts that are very, very important: ontology, epistemology, human nature, and methodology. Now, strangely, social work students get very worried when they hear such big words. It's nothing. These are big words to understand the basic notions of society. What is ontology? Ontology, very simply put, is basically to understand what exists. What is there? For example, that is a chair, this is a table. It exists. And there is nothing very, very scary about it. So it is basically a philosophy that helps you to address the nature of being and reality. And it can be the objective reality and the subjective reality. So if you understand, it's a broad dimension. From the objective, you move on to the subjective. Epistemology is basically about how we come to know about what exists. Now, how do we come to know? Someone tells you, you observe, you interpret, and hence all these methods help you understand what is happening around you. And one very important thing is what we know and how we come to know is existent upon the human nature, how we build relationships with each other, not only human beings, with the environment. I'm sure some of you are very, very attached to your pen or to your copy. That's also a relationship. Human nature needs to be understood from all these dimensions. And finally, the methodology. Now, we know what exists, we know how it exists, and we know what a relationship is with it, with these particular concepts. So methodology basically helps us understand and explore ontology, epistemology, and the human nature. It also helps us to obtain knowledge about the social world. And thus, methodology then becomes the starting vehicle to explore and document ontology, epistemology, and human nature. Now, the dimensions of epistemology and the concepts of epistemology, ontology, human nature, and methodology have a subjective way of looking at things and an objective way of looking at things. Now, the subjective approach to social science within ontology looks at the nominal view or the nominal way of looking at things, which means it also looks at the abstract notions. Epistemologically, it is anti-positivist, which means that it looks into the interpretations and not at what is physically and scientifically visible and discernible. Human nature is voluntarism, and methodology is ideographic. That is, it looks into the unique points and the unique understandings of the way people are and understand the outer world and the inner world. Whereas the objective approach is the bang opposite of this, which means it believes in realism, that is the physical notions that exist, positivism, which is purely scientific, determinism, that is it's set, there has to be a set outcome or a determined outcome, and the methodology is nomothetic, which means it looks towards generalizing. Now, once we understand the subjective and the objective dimension, you would understand that in practice, we are looking at the subjective way of knowing and the objective way of knowing. And Harvey has attempted to explicate the difference between what is seen and what actually happens. Now, let's give you an example for this. For example, you are observing a murder situation. How would an objective person look at it? They would probably go to the murder scene. They will say that the body was lying prostrate. There was so much of blood on the left side or the right side, and the age of the murder victim was ABC, and the person had fallen from a particular height, assuming that they jumped from a building. However, but if a subjective approach is seen, looked at in the same context, the subjective person would attempt to see what were the notions or the identity of the person? Where did the person come from? Was it a rural person? Was it an urban person? Was it a person who had a different subjective understanding of themselves before that particular incident happened? And you would understand that the depth of information that would come from the subjective information would lend itself strongly in giving a holistic picture to that murder scene. And thus, objective versus subjective becomes very, very important. At times, objective is easy. It helps us to organize our small worldview very easily. However, it gets complicated because everyone has got a different set of objective worlds. So, for example, all children go to school. All children go to school, no problems with it. Maybe the curriculum would also be the same in, say, those schools. But the subjective way of looking at it, it would be, do the children get enough nutrition to be able to concentrate in class? Do the children get enough sleep to be able to concentrate in class? If we don't look at all these notions, the way we look at the social problem would be incomplete. And hence, students, you have to be careful. Are you looking at the subjective? Are you looking at the objective? Or are you looking at both? And a holistic practitioner would look at both. The next notion is where the society is seen in a continuum of order and conflict. Very easy. So if you are talking to a police person, he would probably say you have to maintain law and order, and there is going to be no discussion on it. However, if you talk to another person who looks at society very, very differently, they would definitely question, who decided the laws? What is order? Why should I subscribe to that order? And now this perspective is known as the conflict perspective. So to make it simple, If you understand, the figure 2 that you will see later on, it talks about the order view, which talks about stability, integration, functional coordination, and consensus. So you see, it's everything is set. You move in one line and things keep happening. Whereas the conflict view looks at change. It looks at disturbances, disintegration, and coercion. It has got a space to give you an understanding that people are different and people will look at things differently and people will not accept things in the same manner in which it is provided. So the conflict and regulation gives us the regulation and radical change dimension, which is the second important principle for the dimensions which David Howes talked about. The term sociology of regulation is primarily concerned with providing explanations of society which emphasize its underlying unity and cohesiveness. It attempts to explain why society tends to hold together rather than fall apart. Thinking about society along these lines has led to the common euphemism of society, which is said that it functions like a body. Organically. If you notice, we breathe without realizing we are breathing. We do a lot of functions. Your digestion is going on. We are conscious about what we are eating, but we're not conscious about how we are digesting. Similarly, the sociology of regulation assumes that there is a certain functionality in which the order of society continues. And hence it is said that the functions are carried out in a manner where the unity of the whole structure takes the primary focus. Conversely, towards this is the sociology of radical change. This explicates the need for change that should happen in society. It assumes that there is no unity and cohesiveness in society. So you see, it dislocates what was assumed in sociology of regulation. It states that every society has deep-seated structural conflicts and the function of society is the mode of domination which ensures the continuation of structural contradiction. Simply put, this means that the role of society is not a unitary whole. It says the role of society, the roles of norms, values, etc. is to ensure that one set of the society dominates the other, and this domination is primarily to ensure order. So what emerges from this is that order is not a set function. Order is put upon or oppressed upon a few people to ensure the whims and fancies or the needs of the people who hold power. So sociology of radical change contests the presumption of social values. It states social values are not shared as the sociology of regulation believes. Hence, values are imposed, therefore the interest and power and how some groups exercise control, often implicitly over others, is questioned here. So, you have subjectivity, objectivity, you have regulation and you have control on regulation and change on the other side. Now, these two dimensions and the binaries of these dimensions is basically very important for us to understand how the world of object and subject and how order and conflict in society is organized. When you put these dimensions, on the x-axis we have the subjective and the objective, and on the y-axis we have the sociology of regulation of change and the sociology of regulation on the lower side of the y-axis. Now look at the screen and you will see that the x-axis has got the subjective and the objective dimension, and the y-axis has got the sociology of radical change and the sociology of regulation of change on its other end. Now, if you see, wherever there are four quadrants that have arrived or have emerged out of this imposition of x-axis and y-axis. Now, these four quadrants are very, very important, and they will explain what Burrell and Morgan had talked about in their understanding of organizations. And later on, we'll see how David Howe has got it into social work. So this figure 3 that you have just looked at is an analytical frame, and it helps us to see how social theory helps us to identify social problems, to understand social problems, and most importantly, identify the underlying assumptions between those social problems. Now let me give you an example. The issue of child labor, it's fairly common, and people across in all states have been observing it and looking at it. You would come across some child labor agencies which believe in giving services to the child labor, that is, giving them good food and maybe giving them access to education. That would be one set of organizations. Another set of organizations attempt to give them certain skills so that they can break out of child labor and start a new life. There's another set of organizations which is challenging the fact that should child labor exist at all in our country. Now, the problem is the same, child labor. The way we are approaching the problem is different, and the way we are attempting to approach has defined the practice towards that social problem. And these four quadrants are going to help you understand which agency will align itself to which notion of practice. And once we do that, believe me, it's going to be simple for you to step into the world of social work. So, the figure 3 is telling us that what are the specific set of assumptions which are characterizing the way we are looking at the social problem. It gives us the extreme positions. So, it's not essential that I have to be completely subjective and completely objective. I can be subjective, objective as well. And I can move from regulation to change as well. But when and how do I move in these quadrants is not dependent only on me. It is dependent upon where my client system is, how I'm viewing the client system, how the client system is viewing me. All these things will put together and help us arrive at a quadrant where our clients are ready to move with us to take a particular approach. So the figure makes it very, very clear that each paradigm shares a common set of features with its neighbors on the horizontal and vertical axis. One dimension will be different and one dimension will be similar. So you can understand the porousness of the quadrants is quite high, but still the notions of the quadrants are quite different. So the four, now if you look at the screen again, that is figure four, there are four distinct sociological paradigms that are existing. So on the objective and regulation change is the functionist paradigm. Then from the subjective and the regulation change is the interpretive paradigm. Then from the subjective to the radical change, you have the radical humanist. And the radical change in objective, you have the radical structuralist. Now what do they mean? How do we understand them? Very simple. Just keep an eye on that figure and try to understand what I'm trying to say. It will be very, very easy. The functionalist paradigm, as I've already said, is bound by the objective and regulation dimension. The dominant paradigm for practice here is sociological positivism, which I've already explained. It seeks to provide essentially rational explanations of social affairs for effective regulation and control. So, for example, in child labor, it will say, it gives a very simplistic understanding. It says, children are working because they are poor. It does not get into the understanding of why they are poor, why do they continue to be poor, and why their children will always be poor. Those questions are not addressed here. Here, it's a simplistic understanding of poor children are the ones who become child laborers. So it is giving us a very rational explanation, and it's a very limited understanding of the problem technically. And hence, because the problem is viewed in a particular way, when it is looked at scientifically, the solutions are also very practical. So what is the practicality? So they would say that, okay, maybe it means these children need to be provided with good food so that nutrition is taken care of. Or maybe it says that let's look into how do we ensure that they get the best within the given circumstances. So the solutions are practical because the problem is seen as being practical. And this paradigm is often critiqued for being based upon social engineering. So the practice here is characterized by a concern for providing explanations of the status quo. So we are not challenging status quo, we are aligning with status quo. And we are also aligning with the social order. We have complete consensus with what is happening. And one is aligned to the ideas of social integration, solidarity, and probably needs satisfaction. And hence, the practice here is realist, positivist, determinist, and nomothetic. The next paradigm, if you look at the figure again, the interpretive paradigm. This is, if you see, ensconced by the subjective and regulation dimension. This quadrant is concerned with understanding the fundamental nature of social world as it is at the level of subjective experience. So there is space to understand how one is feeling, what is it that the people have within themselves. And it does attempt to look at issues related to the nature of status quo, social order, consensus, social integration and cohesion, solidarity and actuality. So thus, a shift in this paradigm can be seen because the approach is nominalist, anti-positivist, voluntarist and ideographic. So it basically means that it is aligning itself to certain abstract notions. It is looking into the interpretation of the real world. It is attempting to look at certain uniqueness that individuals have. So for example, here I would see child labor as an issue where I would say that no, not all child labor issues are the same. So if we have a child working in the carpet industry, if we have a child working in the firecracker industry, if we have a child working in mining, if we have a child working in certain infrastructures or in the coal mines, you have the stone mines and the coal mines, their reality is different and their concerns are different. It sees the social world as an emergent social process which is created by the individual's concern. This standpoint is underwritten by the assumption that the world of human affairs is cohesive, ordered and integrated, but the human being within that world is open to interpretation of the world in his or her own manner. The radical humanist paradigm has the dimensions of subjective and radical change, and they are the starting point of an anti-positivist approach, which means it has started questioning the ideals of domination, and it is talking about the ideological superstructures that exist in the society. And practice here emphasizes upon radical change, modes of domination, emancipation, deprivation, and potentiality. The next quadrant, students, is the radical structural paradigm, and this is the most liberal paradigm because it is ensconced by the objective and the radical change. It is committed to radical change and emancipation. It strongly questions the structures that exist in society, and as you may guess, it follows a paradigm which was espoused by Marx, Engels, and Lenin. And hence, power here is demystified, and the notions of practice here are that power has to be seized, or power has to be shared equally amongst everyone who exists in this society. So now these four quadrants, if you see students, you look at the next figure, you can see the social work perspectives emerging from it. So the functionalist approach is the fixer's approach. The interpretive approach is the seekers after meaning. The radical humanist is the raisers of consciousness, and the radical structural is the revolutionaries. So now, if you can see, if you've understood what I have talked about, the quadrants in the previous past few minutes, you will understand what these are aligning to. I'll quickly give you a snapshot of these because the next few models are going to talk about them in details. So the fixers are basically looking at people with problems and people as problems. The diagnosis is based upon a rational analysis, and it has an expert's approach attached to it, and the aim is to mend and maintain. The seekers after meaning, they are dominantly the approaches which are known as the client-centered approaches, where we respect the client. The assessment is based upon understanding the client's experiences, and the client is seen as an expert, and the knowledge is gained through a dialogue. And the aim is towards creating new meanings and reducing the clashes in meanings between the person who's working with the client system. The raisers of consciousness, if you remember, it aligns to the radical humanism process or the quadrant. And the problem here lies in the modes of domination, and it aims towards addressing the deprivation. So the assessment is structural analysis, and the methods is about informing people, knowledge creation, and finally collective action. And finally, the revolutionaries, the problem lies in unequal allocation of power and resources, and law is seen as an instrument of the elite. Assessment is definitely structural analysis, and the aim is just reallocation of power, redistribution of wealth and power, and the methods is collective action. So finally, students, if you understand, you will see that there is a wide array of practice within social work, but the context of social work is also changing. One thing that remains the same is that social work is located within some of the most complex problems and perplexing areas of human experience, and for this, social work is and has to be a highly skilled activity. The orthogonal representation by Burrell and Morgan basically has provided an insight to David Howe, and because of David Howe's model, we can see the wide practice in social work and how basic assumptions underline our own practices. So with this, welcome to understanding the where is social work practices, the dimensions of practices, and I hope you have a nice time understanding social work practice.